use what God has given us and what God has made us into to use, to serve others, and to build His kingdom. We can't just simply say, I got mine, I'm on my way to heaven, see you later. Very important for us to look around us in the world and say, these are the ones God has sent us to serve. And so we will do that with pleasure. We'll do that with the power that God has created. This morning we worship with the service as printed in your bulletin. We begin with hymn 582, We'll Rise for the Last Stanza.
Christ, I pray, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner.
Because your people cannot continue in safety without your help, always protect and govern them by your goodness, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Yeah.
in a time of persecution under an evil emperor named Nero. This was not a good time to be a Christian in the Roman Empire, and yet Paul talks about responsibility as Christians that we are not to rebel against authority, because authority in the fourth commandment is something established by God, it's for the good of man, and that by supporting and submitting ourselves to authority, we can be lights in the world, and that we can show that our values in this world are different. In fact, by supporting authority, supporting order in our world, we also are supporting the overall peace and the avenues of communication that allow the gospel to be spread for the salvation of mankind. So we join with Paul in saying, government may not be perfect, but it is from God, and therefore we as Christians will support what God has instituted. Everyone must submit to the governing authorities, for no authority exists except by God, and the authorities that do exist have been established by God. Therefore, the one who rebels against the authority is opposing God's institution, and those who oppose will bring judgment on themselves. For rulers are not a terror to good conduct, but to evil. Would you like to have no fear of the one in authority? Do what is good, and you will receive praise from him, because he is God's servant for your benefit. But if you do wrong, be afraid, because he does not carry the sword without reason. He is God's servant, a punisher to bring wrath on the wrongdoer. Therefore, it is necessary to submit, not only because of wrath, but also because of conscience. For this reason, you also pay taxes, because the authorities are God's ministers who are employed to do this very thing. Pay what you owe to all of them, taxes to whom taxes are owed, revenue to whom revenue is owed, respect to whom respect is owed, and honor to whom honor is owed. Do not owe anyone anything except to love one another. For the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. For the commandments, do not commit adultery, do not murder, do not steal, do not covet, if there are any other commandment, are summed up in this statement, love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no harm to a neighbor. So love is the fulfillment of the law. This is the word of the Lord. Hallelujah. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Hallelujah.
God from God, light from light. kingdom of heaven on earth. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who begins with the Father and the Son, is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken to the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge you in baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Receive your gift.
Man, I feel bad for them, but it's really their problem. people treat other people in trouble says a lot about community. There are parts of our country where people are, I would say, here, around here, people are pretty helpful. If you spend more than 10 minutes looking for something in Lowe's or whatever, some stranger's going to come up and say, hey, you need, if I need something, you know, we are in Michigan, we tend to help people. But there are, not everybody's that way. There are parts of the country where people actually don't give a rip what's going on with you and will not pay a bit of attention. And it says a lot about the community. We're part of the community, this thing that we call Zion Lutheran Church. We're not just here to get what's ours and go home. We're part of a family. We're looking out for each other. And we need to do that because people do get broke down along the side of the road in a spiritual sense. Things happen. Things happen in people's life. They get in danger. They get in trouble. And what do? That's what we need to ask ourselves today. There is that natural impulse in us when we see a brother and sister in trouble with sin to just keep grinding. Maybe we don't care. Maybe we're afraid to help. Of course, that's not how Jesus approaches the troubled soul. And that's not how Jesus would have us approach the troubled soul. And so today he helps us to look at a brother who's in trouble. And he says to us, searches our hearts, says, are you going to win it? Let's see how we can change our attitude. Yes, Jesus wants us to take responsibility for each other. To not casually treat a person who is trapped in sin and just drive on by. But that does come naturally. I mean, it even gets into our attitude, starting with what's in our heart. If your brother sins against you, I mean, the question could be if your brother is trapped in any kind of sin, but sometimes it's the ones that we see that we take personally that we notice the most. If somebody does something to offend me, a sin that directly affects me in some way, how am I going to react? Human reaction usually has to do with how I feel. What's in it for me? Even if it doesn't involve me directly, if I've been a witness to it, Jesus causes us to say, so what do you do? What do you do when a brother is in trouble? It's going to take a change in attitude, isn't it? It's going to take the power of Christ loving me to cause me to take up the burden of my brother, to look beyond the hurt that it might have done me, to look beyond the apathy that says, well, he got himself in trouble, it's his business. Or the elders or the pastor should take care of it. Or his family members should say something about it. What causes you to get into this battle for the soul of your brother? What gets you in? It's that change of heart, isn't it? It is Jesus Christ himself. And it's not just by Jesus' command saying, you really should do this. I mean, you could read it that way. You can look here at Matthew 18. Read it as scolding words and say, you better do this, or else. But maybe he's saying to us, consider your heart. Consider my heart. I mean, what would get us, what would cause us to engage? What would cause us to get in the middle of this problem that our brother may have found himself in? Well, Jesus certainly gives us an example. If your brother sins against you, well, how many sins does that describe against God himself? Is there anybody who has been more grievously offended than Almighty God? Countless examples of our holy and powerful and generous God being spit in the face, starting with his creation of Adam and Eve, who decided to join the devil's team instead of his. Smack in the face! And then God follows up with this beautiful promise that he was going to defeat Satan and bring his children back into his family. And he sets up a whole nation who is going to be the keepers and preservers of that promise, the embodiment of that promise on earth. And when he sends his son in the fulfillment of that promise, they spit in his face. They swear at him and say, crucify him. How do you think God felt? How do you think God feels when he is mocked, when his will is defied, and when it's done even by us? Yes. Every sin we commit in thought, word, and deed, in every hour of our life is a slap in the face to Almighty God. Offended? Is there a word to describe how offended God must be? In God's reaction to this blatant, hateful offense, the spitting and smacking in his face is to love us. And not just like this, but like this, right? To send his one and only son to take the guilt of all of that on himself. To take that guilt to hell where it will not return to accuse us, and to give us his righteousness in exchange. In other words, God's reaction to man trapped in sin is to do what we need, not what we deserve. This is grace. This is the love of Christ. And it's not only the grace and love that saves us from our eternal damnation that we deserve, but it's the love that once used to save us, flows into us, flows through us, and then becomes our power to love our neighbor. Not perfectly, we're still sinners. We're still going to fail, we're still going to feel resentment. But it is the love of Christ that causes us to engage as fellow sinners, to help the brother or sister who's being trapped in sin, who's being taken away from God, who's being removed from his grace, who is jeopardizing their eternity. And not to just say, I got mine, but to look at the brother, to look at the sister and say, what can I do? It's going to get me into their battle. That's why Jesus would say to his disciples, if your brother sins against you, go and show him the sin just between the two of you. If he listens, you have redeemed your brother. This is what the Lord enables in us. This week, you're going back out to the world, and somebody's going to offend you. It could happen immediately after the service. Something somebody says, a look, an attitude, a bad memory, some bad blood. You know, somebody this week is going to be that annoying gossipy person or person who comes back to work on Monday and tells you about the wild party and stuff they did all weekend. The person whose filthy language and nasty innuendos just for the person who takes advantage of your kindness and honesty and profits at your expense. What are you going to do? What are you going to do if that's a Christian? What are you going to do if that's a brother and sister in faith here at Zion or elsewhere? Get angry, get revenge. Feel all holier than thou. Or in the eyes of Christ, are you going to look at that brother and sister and say, given me a heart, and I'm not going to stand by while you destroy your soul. Of course, there's always that issue of why do I get involved in something I can't really help with anyway? So let's say that you drive by and you're in Pennsylvania and there's a pair of blinky lights and say, you know what, I don't know which end of the screwdriver to use. I don't know anything about fixing cars. Even though I may have compassion for them, even though I may feel sorry for them, what good is it going to do for me to pull over? I'm not equipped to help them. It's another reason that we maybe keep driving. But Jesus does tell us that that is not a necessary attitude to have, because we do have tools that are necessary for the soul that is being threatened by sin. Interesting. If your brother sins against you, go and show him his sin just between the two of you. If he listens to you, you regain your brother. Well, there's a win-win. Stop, your help, it's over with. But usually it doesn't work that way, does it? If you will not listen, take one or two along with you, so that every man may be established by the testimony of two or three witnesses. If he refuses to listen to them, talk to the church. And if he refuses to listen even to the church, then treat him as an unbeliever or a tax collector. That is, that's getting wow, okay. Oh, man. There's a lot of stuff to do here. I'm turning into a really annoying person now. No, you're not. You're turning into a persistent person. A person who won't give up on a soul that might be lost. What does that mean? It means, number one, that compassion that we already talked about has to come out of you. Even though that person has hardened in their sin, at one level or another, we never stop wishing for their repentance and their return to God. And number two, it's confidence that God has actually equipped us to take care of us. And how has he done it? We have his eyes. It's called one gospel. We see a situation the way God sees a situation. The eyes of God, of the law, see what's right and what's wrong. And we know that what's wrong is not just a matter of I'm being judgmental or I'm holier than thou. It means that God has said some things are right and some things are wrong. And when you violate my will, you are destroying your soul. You're breaking your relationship with God. It's God who says it. It's not me. It's not man-made rules. It's the eyes of God. And looking with the eyes of God is a situation, and a situation that I'm saying, this is destructive. And I want my brother to see through the eyes of God too. Because my brother is going to say, get lost, buddy. Who are you to judge me? My brother might say to me, that's your opinion. But I don't think so. Your brother may say, give you 1,000 good reasons why he doesn't have to do the right thing. And they may sound really good, but not in the eyes of God. And those steps that Jesus outlines there are a continuation of the seriousness of the law. It's saying to the brother and sister in faith who is being trapped by sin and saying, no. The This is what God says. And I want you to turn away for your good. I'll talk to you personally because I don't want to make an issue. I don't want to make this public. I don't want to ruin your reputation. But if you tell me to get lost, I'm going to bring some fellow Christians with me so that you can see it's not personal, it's not in my opinion, but that we together, and if you refuse that admonition, you need to talk to the church. And when sin is so completely ingrained and there's no penitence, we're going to make you know your losses. Because we're only joking, because we want you to turn. We want you to see yourself as God sees. All centered in what? If your brother listens, you win. You see, the big tool that we carry with us all the time is the gospel that dwells in our heart. The law is only the first step. Seeing the deadness of sin through the eyes of God, and then it's the gospel that sees those sins nailed to the cross. It's the privilege we have, not on our own, not by our own judgment. Just like the law is not our judgment, we're speaking for Christ who says, forgive. Isn't that wonderful? That our goal, that our heart is not to make a person feel bad. Our goal is to make them see Christ. To offer them the forgiveness that Jesus purchased and won for them. To offer it without condition. To offer it with an eager heart that says, my brother, my sister, I want you to know you're forgiven. There's nothing greater than to have you say, I'm sorry, and to simply say to Christ, you are forgiven. You see, you stay in the game just for that. It's all worth it, isn't it? No matter what they have to go through to cross that line and to finally be able to say to that brother and sister, in Christ you are forgiven. It's the reward for having a heart for the lost. He wins. You win. The devil loses. And so with the heart that reaches out to somebody who's hurting and trapped, with the power of God's word in our hand, we go forward and we are in it to win it. Look around you. These are the people that we are responsible for, each other. You're not just here to get yours and go home. Will you see everyone in here in heaven someday? Oh, my Lord, we pray that is so. Will you make sure, with the power and the opportunities that have been given to you, that happens? Oh, Lord, may that be so. That we would never look at the people here, the dear flock of which we are members, and not feel that strong, strong bond of responsibility to walk together, to have the responsibility and the privilege to share with the great shepherd of the sheep in shepherding his flock. Yeah, it's hard for me to say, Lions fan, I quote Vince Lombardi, you know, it's off, but I'm going to have to. Because it's no more true in God's community of believers to say winning isn't just the best thing, it's the only thing. That's what we're here to do. That's good. God fulfilling with all joy and peace that we believe in Christ, that you may abound in hope through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Lord be with you.
Holy Father, Almighty and Everlasting God, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who promised that wherever two or three come together in his name, there he is with them to shepherd his flock till he comes again in glory. Therefore, with all the saints on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise their holy name and join their glorious song.
Thank you.
Take me and send the true body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, which he gave to death, even the death of the cross, for the forgiveness of all your sins. Take me, this is the true body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Take and drink, this is the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, which he shed for you and for many as the full payment.
Thank you.
thanks this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you